Welcome to this IoT big data stream mining tutorial. My name is Albert Bifet. I'm associate professor at Telecom ParisTech. I'm one of the organizers of this tutorial. So as you know, IoT is, for many people, is becoming the next big thing. So it's a thing that is going to grow in the next 5 years. So we hope that with this tutorial, you get an introduction of what is IoT data analytics. There's a lot of topics there. It's what we are teaching in our courses. So it's a bit difficult to put all of these in only 3 hours. We did our best. So we hope that you will enjoy it. So let's start first. Let me present the other organizers. So Gianmarco De Francisci Morales, he's a scientist at Qatar Computing Research Institute. So he has been working on many works on data stream engines and data stream mining. And he's one of the founders of Apache Samoa, a project that was started when he was at Yahoo Labs in Barcelona. Me, Albert Bifet, that I'm associate professor at Telecom ParisTech, and I'm also one of the founders of Apache Samoa and also one of the leaders of MOA, that is a software also for mining data streams from University of Waikato from the Weka Machine Learning Group. We have also Latifur Khan, that is a full professor in the University of Texas at Dallas. He's also very well known for all his works in data stream mining, also especially in neural detection. And also João Gama, that is associate professor at the University of Porto, and also he has been working in data stream mining, and he has also this very popular book on data stream mining. And finally, Gui Fan, that is the deputy head at Baidu Research Big Data Lab, that he has been also working in many different data stream mining topics. And that also when he was at Huawei, he developed this Huawei Stream Smart system. That is a system for mining data streams. Okay, so this is the outline of our tutorial. So we divide it into two parts. The first one is going to be the fundamentals of IoT stream mining. And the second part is going to be about distributed stream mining. So we put the slides in the web. So you will, it's in this URL link, sitegoogle.com, site IoT mining tutorial. You will find there the slides of the tutorial. So we're going to divide the tutorial into parts. The first part is going to be these fundamentals. We are going to do this before the coffee break. And then after the coffee break, we'll try to do the distributed stream mining. So the first part, what we are going to do is we are going to introduce first the Internet of Things setting. Then we are going to go to classification, regression, and concept drift. Then we'll see clustering. We'll see also some frequent item set mining. And we'll finish with concept evolution and limited label learning. In the second part, we'll start with an introduction to distributed stream processing engines. So we talk about Spark, Flink, Storm, also Kafka. And then we'll see some classification and regression methods, some open source tools for mining big data streams, and finally some applications and conclusions. Okay, so let's start. So let me start motivating a little bit the Internet of Things setting. So mainly I would like to motivate why this is going to be really important. So why this is going to be the next big thing. So you know the Internet of Things is this of this set of sensors and actuators that are connected by networks to computing systems. So the prediction is that this is something that is going to grow. There are many different predictions. We see this Gartner that is predicting that we're going to have 20 billion IoT devices by 2020. IDC that is projecting 32 billion IoT devices. So this is something that is going to be really, really important. If we look at this chart is from EMC Digital Universe 2014. So the idea is that they try to estimate what is the size of the digital universe, so all the data that we can find. And the interesting thing is that if we look at the percentage of the IoT, so in 2013 or until now, 2016, this IoT data was only about 4%. But now the expectation is that in 2020 this is going to be around 11%, and it still is going to grow. And you can see that this is not growing linearly, this is going to grow exponentially. So that means that this is something that is going to be really, really important in the next few years. The same study has this chart that is it tries to show what is the economic impact of IoT. So if we compare the traditional ICT technologies, we see that this is the dark blue. We see that this is something that is going to be growing. But what is more interesting and exciting is that this IoT specific is something that is going to grow. And as you see at the beginning, 2013, 2014, is still very small. But when we look at 2020, this is something that is going to become really huge as traditional ICT. So that means that this is something that is going to be really, really big, really huge, and really important. If we look at the applications of IoT, so we have this study from McKinsey that they were trying to see what's going to be this economical impact and what were the specific applications that are going to have a huge impact. So one of the main important is healthcare. So you can imagine that all of this information that we are going to have in these sensors that is going to be applied to everybody, this is going to help a lot. This is going to save. We are going to improve with this data. We can improve the health of people. And we can also increase the expectancy of life. But also we can help the doctors and the nurses to spend less time and to do the same work in a much effective way. So this is something that is going to have a very huge impact. Another one is industry. So industry is a very important field that I'm going also to mention it later. It's really going to be very, very important in the sense that all of the IoT data that is going to be produced inside the factories are going to allow us to try to go for this ideal of having a perfect automatic factories that they can manage themselves. You know, they can look at what they are doing and try to self-repair, to self-manage, to self everything. No? So that's the main idea. Also, of course, we have what is energy, the sector of energy. This is something that IoT is going to be very, very useful to increase the performance and to increase also the value that we are getting there. And also, yeah, we have the very popular smart cities. All that happens in the cities and all of these sensors that are going to be available there, this is also going to be, are going to allow us to do many, many, many things, and we are going also to be much efficient in how we manage our transportation, how we manage all the things that happens in the cities. So as I said, the main idea is that IoT is going to be really, really important. It's going to change many things in our daily life. Industry is something that is going to be very, very attractive for IoT because we have this definition of Industry 4.0 that is from the German government. The idea is that we have these several industrial revolutions. So the first one was the first industrial revolution when we started with the steam machines. Then the second one was the one when we had the electricity. The third one was when we started having computers applied inside the factories. And this last revolution, the fourth revolution, is going to be the one that everything is going to be connected inside the factory, and we are going to have all the data from the factory, what is happening inside the factory. So if we look at the four properties of this Industry 4.0, there are two. The first one is this capability of interoperability, that this is something that is going to be done through the Internet of Things. And the second one is this information transparency. So the idea is that we're going to have a copy of we are going to have the data of what is happening inside the factory. So we are going to have a virtual copy of everything. So everything that is happening there, we are going to have it in a digital way. So we are going to be able to use all of this information. And then the important thing there is, so why this IoT in factories? So basically for two things. One is for supporting, for helping to make humans human decisions. And this is also something that could be very, very important and challenging, is to be able to make these centralized decisions. So make so that the factory, they could automate decisions and they could be able to make decisions on their own. So you see that one of the main important things of Industry 4.0 is to have these analytics to help to make decisions. Usually that analysis always is very useful to help to make better decisions. And then we'll see that in that case, in Industry 4.0, IoT is also going to help to do this. So all, as you can see, all of this data that comes from sensors is data that is produced in real time. So here we cannot use the standard machine learning data mining methods where we suppose that we have finite training sets and we have static models and we don't need to update, we don't need to change the data. If we look at, this is an example. So here we have two classifiers. So one is not updated. So this is the initial one that is in blue. And then we see the other one that is the one that is updated continuously. That is the one on red. What we see is that the performance of the one that is not updated, the performance is going down. The accuracy is going down. Instead, the one that is updated for each is updated online, we see that the performance is going, is maintaining high. So this is why it's important to be able to update our models on real time. The other alternative is to update the models in a periodic basis. No? So we say, okay, so we are going to update our model in every year, every month, every week, every day. The problem is that, as you see, whenever we are not updating our model, the performance of our models are not getting, are decreasing, the performance is decreasing, and we are not getting the same value from the data. So yeah, this is something that is very important, is to know where is the value of the data. So here is a nice chart where we see that the data value on the axis, and the other we see what is the data age. So what we see is that the value of individual items are higher at the beginning when the data is recent. So then when we have new data that is arriving and the data is recent, then the value for the individual item is really, really high. But this is something that is going down when the time goes by. But then at that time, what is getting value is the value of data, of aggregated data. So what happened 1 week ago, this is something that could be useful if we use this as an aggregate data of what all the customers, of what all the people were doing at that time. So this is why when we are dealing with critical data, when we are dealing with real-time events, then what is important is the data that has recently arrived, because the value of this data is much, much higher. So this IoT stream mining setting, basically what we try to do is to maintain these models online. So data is going to be arriving continuously, and we want to incorporate this to our models. We have to suppose that data is not fixed, so it's, data is not a static data set. Data is going to be continuously arriving, so we need to be able to deal with this type of data. And the most important thing is that this the model, the data that is arriving is going to be changing. So we need to update our models, and we need to change our models to this setting. So these IoT big data streams, so we can see this IoT data also as big data, in the sense that still the quantity of this is going to be very, very fast. And we are also going to have the same Vs, no, volume, high velocity, especially, but also variety. So in that sense, IoT, what is going to do is going to make big data bigger. Because we are, the quantity of data that is going to be produced from sensors is so high that we can see that big data still is going to be alive and still is going to be with much more data to deal. So yeah, to deal with all of this large data, we need also to use large clusters of computers. So we need also to see how we can do that in a distributed and in a scalable way. So as you see, when we have all of this data that is arriving, so we need to be very, very fast to process all of this data. We cannot store the data and then we start doing several passes, because if we do that, then new data is arriving at the same time. So we cannot do that. We need to be very, very fast. And usually what we do is that we look on the data only once. So we do only one pass over the data. And usually what we do is that we are happy with approximate solutions. So instead of having the exact solution that is going to take a lot of time to compute, what we are doing is that we are happy with an approximate solution that with a small error, epsilon, will have with high probability, 1 minus delta, will have a solution. So yeah, this is very important. And you will see that most of the methods in streaming are always approximate and are always trying to do it very, very fast, but in also at the same time in an approximate way where we have parameters where we can decide what is going to be our error and what is going to be our probability. So let me show you only an example. So imagine that we have these 8 bits and we want to store a number. So what is the largest number that we can store there? So yeah, I think that you may say that this is from 0 to 255. No, so it's 256 numbers. This is the standard thing. So if we use this streaming mentality, we would like to put more data there. We would like to put a number higher than 256. So I mentioned this because this was the first paper in streaming. So the first paper that we can say that this was the first paper streaming algorithm was this paper by Robert Morris at Bell Laboratories that was presenting a method to put more numbers inside these counters, inside these 8-bit counters. So the idea is, so we will see, we can see that he was able to put 130,000 events in using only 8 bits. So the big question is how we can do that. So how we can put 130,000 events in only 8-bit counter. Yeah, the only way is to put, instead of storing the counter, the count, we store the logarithmic of the count. That's the idea. So you see this graph, the idea is that the blue line is the linear function, and then the idea is that instead of storing the linear function, we're going to store the logarithmic function. And then doing this, we are able to store more a high number, a high quantity. As you see here, we see we are using a logarithmic, and then we are normalizing to have the first value to 0, and also to have the value of 1 into 1. The problem of this we see is that at the beginning, we would like to have something that is more similar to a counter, no? At least from 0 to 10. So a way to do that, it's something possible, is that instead of using logarithmic of 1 plus x, we can do 1 plus x divided by 30. And then what we have is at the beginning, we'll see that we are going to store the logarithmic, but it's going to be similar to the standard counter. So the idea then is that, so this is from 0 to 10. If we see from 0 to 100, what we see is that we are storing at the beginning as a counter, and then at the end we are using this logarithmic function. So I think this is a very nice idea. And the way to implement this is very, very simple. So if in the standard counter, what we are doing is that for each new event that arrives, what we do is that we update the counter with 1. So here, we are going to do that probabilistically. So we are going to take a random number between 0 and 1, and we cite probability p. If this number is less than this, then we update the counter with 1. And if not, we don't update it. So this is the way how we can store this information. So yeah, I think this was a very nice example of how we can, how stream algorithms work. And you see that we are going to use many, many of these tricks. So try to use these probabilistic methods so that we can do in an approximate way the same thing, but faster and using less amount of memory.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Albert. So this part of the tutorial is about predictive learning. We're going to talk about two main learning tasks. It's not okay? It's okay now? Okay, so this part is about the learning tasks. We will refer to some algorithms for classification and regression. Typically, in the batch scenario, the classification and regression are algorithms designed for stationary distributions. In streaming setting, we need to deal with evolving distributions, so non-stationary distributions. We will talk techniques for dealing with non-stationary distributions in the concept drift part. So for classification, the goal is assign a label to an example. This label takes values in a finite set, and the set of possible class labels is known. Some examples of classification tasks are, for example, email spams and sentiment analysis of Twitter sentence. So the overall process in streaming setting, we need one pass algorithms. So we receive, we are always in this loop. We receive training examples. We need to process the examples one example at a time, using limited memory and limited time. So second is prediction. So for each example, you need to predict, might need to predict a class label, and we need to be able to do any time prediction. The third step is when we receive test examples and our decision model makes the predictions. So the first algorithm that can be used in the streaming settings is the well-known naive bias. Naive bias is has been studied since the 50s and is common used, for example, in text mining. No, the naive bias is a generative model. Basically, if you want to assign a class label to an example, we compute posterior probability of the class given the example, and we choose the class. We do it for all the possible classes, and we choose the class that maximizes the posterior probability. The posterior probability is computed using the Bayes theorem. So you to compute posterior probability, you compute likelihood of the example given a class times the prior probability of observing that class. This can be divided by the probability of observing this evidence. And the naive bias trick is to compute the likelihood that we know that it requires to compute joint probability of all the attributes. And this is the number of probabilities is exponential in number of the attributes. And naive bias assumption is that the attributes are independent given class label. So to compute this likelihood, the product of probability of each attribute given the class label. This assumption is why the algorithm is called naive bias. Although naive bias is a simple algorithm, it is quite powerful. another algorithm that can be used for streaming data is the perceptron. As in the case of knife bias, this is a linear classifier. Perceptron typically requires iterations over the training data. The need to iterate over training data is mainly due to the lack of data. If you have data enough, we don't need to iterate the over training data. So the perceptron is a linear combination of the attributes, and the decision model is a set of weights for each attribute, and is can be represented here. So, to give an example to compute to predict a class label, we compute the linear function and use the because it this is for two class problems, we apply a sigmoid. The sigmoid has a nice property that is the derivative of the sigmoid is given by this expression. The perceptron rule to update to learn the weights, it scans the examples at each time updates the weights. And the update the weights using the delta rule. Typically, if you want to minimize mean square error that is given by this expression between, so this the sum, square sum of the sum of the squares of the difference between predictions and observed values, we follow the gradient descent approach. So for each example, the set of weights for the next iteration are the current set of the weights plus a learning rate and the delta, the update over the weight for this particular attribute. This is derived from here, and to compute gradient descent, use the derivatives. So the algorithm for perceptron learning, we learn a perceptron for each class, and each example is considered or a positive example of that class, or if it is from any other class, is a negative example for that class. So for each class, we learn a perceptron, and this is the learning algorithm to compute the weights for the attributes. Basically, if the class label of that example is the positive, is the, of the same class that you are learning the perceptron, we compute the delta as this given by this expression. Basically, we estimate the value predicted for the current model for this example, and if the value predicted by the current model is 1, that means predict that class, this difference is 0, so there is no, the update is 0. So if the example is correctly classified, you don't change the weight. Otherwise, we modify the weights such that goes in direction to correctly classify the example. For predicting a class label for a given a test example, we compute the class that maximizes the value predicted by the perceptron. So, but the most used learning algorithms in streaming set are decision trees. Decision trees are very high degree of interpretability of the models, and there are fast algorithms to learn decision trees. Decision trees are independent of monotonic transformations of the input variables, are independent of distribution generating examples and so forth, are independent of the scale of the variables. So this is the a decision tree. A decision tree is a set of tests in the attribute values, and each test has two possible outcomes in that case, yes or no, and each example traverses the tree following the, depending on the attribute values, the paths follow from the query, the questions at each node. The leaf, at the leaves of the tree, a decision is made that basically it's the class that will be assigned to the example of that query. So the top-down induction of decision trees use a grid regression algorithm, sort the examples are sorted through the tree, and they are classified in the, so for each, at each node, we select the attribute using some heuristic function, the attribute that most discriminates between the class labels, and this, the most discriminative attribute select for test at that node. And the examples are passed down on the test, on the node, and recursively we applied the same algorithm to expand the tree. For stopping criteria, say that typically depends on the number of examples, we stop the recursive procedure. The top-down induction of decision trees is an algorithm that its complexity is n times logarithmic number of examples, and there were several approaches in the 90s to design incremental decision trees algorithms, but the first full incremental decision tree algorithm appears in the paper in KDD 2000, the very fast mining high-speed data streams. This paper was considered 2 years ago, in KDD 2 years ago, the most influential paper, KDD 10 years ago. So the basic idea is instead of processing the full training data, we select a sample and select the most discriminative attribute in that sample. The problem is how large should be the sample? And the idea is, so you collect sufficient statistics from a small set of examples. We estimate the merit of each attribute. And if the difference in the merit of the two most discriminative algorithms is this difference is statistically significant, we assume that you have evidence or you have a sample size that allow us to discriminate between the two best alternatives. If the difference between the merit of the two most discriminative attributes is not statistically significant, this means that we have not yet, you don't have evidence, you don't have data enough to make a decision. You need to collect more information. So this is how we decide when the difference between the two most significant discriminative attributes is significant or no, or not. We use the Hofstede bound that is given by this expression. If the difference of the merit of the two best attributes is greater than epsilon, we have evidence enough to make a decision. Otherwise, we need to collect more information. The Hofstede bound is independent of distribution generating examples, and this R, this capital R, is the range of the random variable. For example, in the case of entropy, the entropy is the maximum value of the entropy is the logarithm of number of classes. So this is the range of the random variable. This is user confidence, desired confidence, the delta, and the in the denominator is number n is the number of examples collected so far in the sample. As we collect more examples, this term grows and the epsilon decreases. So this is this type of algorithms. These algorithms that use the Hofstede bound to as a criteria to decide when there is information enough to make a decision is known as Hofstede algorithms. And for Hofstede trees, this is the basic algorithm. So but we process. This is a one-pass algorithm. For each algorithm, for each example, we scan the example through the tree, and we update sufficient statistics at the leaf. And basically, the algorithm is doing that. We read one example, scan the example through the current model, and update the counters at the leaf, and so forth. Time to time, if we have a minimum number of examples in the leaf, we compute the merit of each attribute, and we compute the difference in the merit of the two best attributes. If this difference satisfies the Hofstede bound, we expand the tree. Otherwise, we collect more information. So this is the basic algorithm. This algorithm has very interesting properties. One of them is that the number of examples to make a decision, that is, expanding a tree, only depends on the Hofstede bound. This means that when we grow a tree, the sample size to make a decision at each node is might be different. Say, to expand the root, you can use, say, 200 examples, and to expand a node, a descendant node, you can use, say, 500 examples. So it only depends on the Hofstede bound. This type of models has interesting properties from a bias variance error composition. One of them is that the offsetting trees are known to have low variance because we only make a decision, expand a tree, if there is statistical evidence for that. There is low overfitting because examples are processed only once. There is no need for pruning offsetting trees. And there are theoretical guarantees that the offsetting algorithms asymptotically close to bachelor and learner, the expected disagreement depends on the user confidence level divided by P, that probability that an instance falls into a leaf. There are cases where, for example, if we have a duplicate attribute, the merit of these two attributes is always equal. That can be cause problems in the basic algorithm we have presented. There are ways of dealing with this case, and one of them is solving ties using when epsilon decreases with number of examples. If epsilon is lower than constant, we decide to expand even if the difference is not greater than epsilon. This is called solving ties. So these are some algorithms commonly used for classification tasks. In regression tasks, that is also predictive learning, where the goal is function approximation, so or learn a model that predicts a value for every unlabeled example. So, for example, stock price, airplane delays, and so forth. Basic algorithm for regression is a linear algorithm, like perceptron, that is quite similar as in the case of classification, but what changes is the loss function. While in classification you have a 0-1 loss function, in regression typically you want to minimize the minimum square error. But the algorithm is exactly the same. It's a linear combination of the attributes, and these weights are learned using gradient descent. As in the case of classification, we have also regression trees that has the same structure as a decision trees, but the leaves, instead of classifying the examples using the mode of the examples that fall in that leaf, we make predictions using the average of the target value for the examples of that leaf. So you use the average if you want to minimize the mean square error, or you can use, for example, the median if you want to minimize the mean absolute deviation. A typical model in the regression trees is to have linear models at the leaves instead of the average of target value. This idea was suggested by in the 80s by Leon Breman and in the CART book. In the case of regression trees, also the merit function typically used, we select the merit function to select the attributes as splitting for splitting tests. We select the attribute that most reduce the standard deviations of the target values. So this is the reduction in standard deviation provided by testing the attribute. Also, we have developed recently rules, decision regression rules, as predictive models. Regression rules can be used also for classification tasks, and basically the rules, the decision model for using the rules is a set of conditions based on attribute values. This is the, and it's a rule is basically is a implication of the form, a set of antecedents that implies a consequent, where the antecedent is a conjunction of tests in the attribute values. The advantage of rules is that rules are a high degree of modularity. Rules can be interpreted per se, individual rules can be interpreted per se. While, for example, if you compare with decision trees, where we have each condition in a node depends on the conditions in the previous nodes. While in the case of rules, because we have conjunctions, and conjunctions are commutative. So these conditions are commutative. So in ECML-PKDD, we presented an algorithm to learn adaptive model rules. Model rules are decision rules where the consequent is a linear model. So we learn a set of rules. Each rule is an implication of antecedent and consequent. And the consequent of a rule is a linear model. when you want to predict for a test example, we check the rules that trigger for that example, that is, the rules for where the antecedent is true, all the conditions in the entry is true for that example. And for those rules, we compute the linear model in the consequent. If several rules trigger for an example, we average the predictions of the linear models. It can, its rule set is a set of rules and a default rule. A default rule is a rule without antecedents. So it triggers for any example. This default rule is used to predict for examples that has not been triggered for any rule. This is the main algorithm. So the IAM rules use the offloading bound to define the sample size to make decisions. In that case, making a decision is when insert in a rule a new condition. So this is when to decide to expand rules. And IAM rules is able to detect change in the process that is generating data. So, and for to detect change, use the page winklet test that we'll describe later in the concept drift, in the concept drift the section. We also, because in online learning, it's important to select, to avoid outliers. So typically outliers is done in a pre-processing phase. In that case, we detect outliers in real time, when we are growing a decision model. Basically, the outlier, an example is considered outlier, is depending on the rule that trigger for that example. And an example is considering an outlier if the probability of observing these attribute values given the set of examples observed so far by that rule satisfies the 3-sigma rule. So for concept drift, concept drift means that the concept we are learning change from over time, and in online learning, in learning from evolving data, we need to check if the data that we are observing so far, observing now, comes from the same distribution of the data that was observed in the past. For typical applications are fault detection or detecting intrusion or false alarms. So, this is a general schema for change detection. So basically, this is input data, and we have some estimator that measures the likelihood of observing this data, and we compare, we pass to a change detector. This change detector compares the estimator of the current data and with the memory or the data observed in the past, and if detect change, signal an alarm. So change detection has been studied a long time ago, at least from the 50s. There were a lot of studies in change detection. This is one cumulative sum, is a family of algorithms that basically compare from a signal if the how like the likelihood of the observed value and the mean is a detect change in the mean of a signal. if current values is deviate significantly from the mean, it signals an alarm. The most commonly used cumulative sum algorithms is page winklet test that the page winklet test is a sequential test that compares, stores the a sum of the observed value and the difference of the observed value through the mean so far. And it accumulates those differences. And at each point, it computes the minimum of these statistics. And it signals an alarm when the minimum or the current value of the sum of the difference and the minimum observed so far is greater than a threshold. So if this difference is greater than a threshold, it signal an alarm. And this alarm means the mean significance of this alarm is there is a deviation in the mean of the observed value. So the page winklet test is a memory-less algorithm because only requires to store two values, the cumulative sum and the minimum of the values observed so far of the cumulative value. But it's a test, it assumes a normal distribution of the signal. We have presented a drift detector for predictive learning, but the basic idea is we look at learning as a continuous process and we use statistical process control to monitor the quality of the learning process. So basically, we monitor the evolution of the error rate, and at each moment we consider the minimum error rate observed so far, taking into account the variance of this estimator. When you compute the error rate, use a sample, set of examples observed so far, and there is a variance associated with this estimate. If you take into account this estimator, we can check when the significant increase of the error rate. If the error rate grows till using the three sigma rule, three times the minimum observed so far, we declare that it's drift level, and means that the data that you are observing so far, observing now, comes from a different distribution of data observed in the past. If the data is twice the minimum observed so far, we reach what we call a warning level, and that when at the warning level, we don't update the decision models with the incoming examples, but we store these examples in a short-term memory that is used to restart the decision model if we reach the drift level. Okay. So Pedro Domingos and Geoff Hulton presented also in 2001 the mining time change in data streams. This mining time change in data streams is basically an extension of the very fast decision tree for the time evolving and time changing domains. And basically, the idea is to monitor the consistent of the select of the learned splitting tests learned in the past, and they check if those splitting tests will be selected in a window all over the most recent examples. So this is basically idea, but the learning time and memory required for that because of the need to store the examples inside the window increases significantly. An approach for adapting to detect change is using, we monitor the error rate and when I must call your attention because in the concept adapting VFTT, there is an interesting idea is when a change is detected at a given node, the model starts learning an alternate tree. And they only replace the old subtree with the alternate subtree when the alternate subtree has a similar performance. The VFTTC, basically we monitor the error rate at all nodes of a decision tree. When new examples come, each node makes a prediction for that example, and we monitor the error rate. So this is with training examples, labeled examples. And after we compare the error rate at each node with the error rate, the sum of the error rates at the leaves of the subtree of this descending from that node. And if the sum of the error rates at the leaves is equal or larger than the error rate at that node, we prune the subnode, the subtree. And the advantage is there is no need for storing a window of examples. It's we only store in memory one example at a time. So the Albert proposed the offing adaptative trees, basically use the you compare the frequency counters and replace frequency counters by estimators. And after you compare the estimators. No. This is a parameter change and use the Hadwin algorithm to detect when there is a significance of the difference. So again, this algorithm doesn't require to store sliding window of examples. So this is about predictive learning. I don't know if there is any question. So this is what we have presented is what we think that are the most representative algorithms for predictive learning in streams. So, for clustering and clustering from streams, so the idea is given a set of examples. We want to learn groups of examples, groups of homogeneous groups of examples. So, for example, this is used in market segmentation, so group clients with similar characteristics, or social network identifying communities in social networks. There are several approaches for clustering in streams, mostly based on are distance-based, but there are also density-based, a kernel base, and so forth. A powerful idea in clustering from streams is the concept of microclusters. This is a way of compact information. The using microclusters, the space required to for the storing information about clusters is independent of the number of observations. Basically, microcluster is a triplet of the number of examples in a cluster, the sum of the values for each dimension of that of the points in that cluster, and the sum of the square values. So so these are say microclusters, and this set of points is we represent information of this set of points using a triplet with this information. The interesting property is that using these cluster features, we can compute the centroid, the radius, and diameter of the microcluster without requiring to store the data points. And moreover, these statistics are easily to update. So, based on the concept of microcluster was presented in Sigmoid 96 in the Birk algorithm for very large clustering in very large database, but is nowadays they are used for several clustering algorithms for streams. The first one was Agrawal ClueStream, present in very large database VLDB03, and the idea is to store to divide clustering process into two phases, online phase where the input is the stream of data points, and they store microclusters. In that phase, they need to, there is a parameter that is the maximum radius for a microcluster. So the online phase receives the input stream and maintains a set of kappa k microclusters. At any time, they can apply over the set of microclusters, they can apply any clustering, batch clustering, cluster algorithm. So this allows different types of analysis. namely how the set of or the cluster structure evolves over time. So we can analyze for different types of clustering algorithms, different number of clusters, and basically how the cluster structure evolves. Another approach, DBScan, that is while ClueStream is a distance-based approach, DBScan is a density-based approach. The main idea of DBScan is concept of epsilon neighborhood of a point, that is a set of points that are at the distance less than epsilon at a given point. And they define core objects, the objects where this neighborhood is as a weight greater than a mu constant. So this the weight is the number of objects inside the neighborhood of the cube. So by computing the neighborhood of a point, they can select points that are connected because they belong to the neighborhood of points that are of other points. So this means that the type of clusters designed by DBScan are not spherical. They can design clusters of any shape. Another algorithm, an extension of DBScan, was presented in STM06, and the extension by identifying and removing outliers from the analysis. To finalize the clustering part, the evaluation of the quality of the clusters learned in this context. If you go look for static evaluation, there are typically two different criterion. One is internal, that basically measures the consistency of the cluster structure. So basically they measure the inter-cluster distance and intra-cluster distance. And from that, we can have how it can estimate the quality of the cluster structure. If you have access to the ground truth, so there are other criterions, that external criterions, basically measuring the purity or of the clusters that we find. For streaming evaluation, an interesting paper presented in KDD 11 by including Albert, that take into account that in streaming clusters may move. New clusters can appear, clusters can disappear, clusters can merge, and so forth. So we need to identify missing points that are not assigned to any cluster, misclassified points, that are points that are classified at different clusters, and noisy points. The proposal in this paper, if you have access to a ground truth, we can, for streaming evaluation of clusters, we need to have it's a normalized sum of these criterion.